There's a lot of moving parts to the global economy. Much of it emanated originally from UK and Mr. Carney as their Monetary Policy Committee met. No changes, but there's a lot more going on quickly. Eurozone rates are negative out to 8 years, in France out to 6 years, in Switzerland out to 10 years. In Japan, even their 10-year now is negative, even though they've had it under major control. These are all issues that have to affect the U.S. Question is, how much?
Rick, I think it all starts with the weakening European economies. Even today, everywhere you look, everything is horrible. I mean, you know, you have, what, factory orders and industrial production in Germany down 7% and 4% year over year. You've got, as you just mentioned, 10-year bunds at 10 basis points. Everything else inside of that is negative. The Bank of England came out today, and they see more and more risks. I mean, the Brits have really shot themselves in the foot with this Brexit and the lack of negotiation. And a lot of it is due to the weakness out of China, even though China wasn't mentioned today. I mean, as I just mentioned to you off the air, I mean, you had three-month LIBOR move the most it's moved in 10 years today, 4.1 basis points. I just don't see how it doesn't affect the U.S., and it doesn't affect this Fed.
Now, if you're an investor watching, Andy, what advice would you give him? It doesn't mean that various shares that you have an affinity for can't do well, but generically in the macro, how do we deal with the exportation of this slowing into the U.S. economy?
Rick, there's no way that the U.S. economy can sustain the growth that it currently has with the world crumbling around it, whether it be Europe, whether it be China, whether it be anywhere else. All right, you have to take that in consideration. And we heard Quarles mention something last night about how he's looking at the global economies. You have to continue to look at it, and you have to recognize that you may have to use the balance sheet and the reverse of what you're doing, even though both you and I hate that idea of the Fed getting more involved, but you got to keep those options open. Nothing is like watching paint dry. That doesn't exist.
Now, as far as Brexit, I know that obviously that some type of an exit strategy would be best versus a no exit strategy. But in the final analysis, no matter how it turns out, Andy, don't you think that there's some buying opportunities after the point of uncertainty leaves, no matter how the exit is described?
Rick, you and I have both been in this business a long time. You want to buy when there's blood on the streets. And I don't mean that in anything more than when everyone is selling and things get real bad. Yes, you do want to step in. But I don't think that time is yet in Brexit. And I think there's a lot more pain that's going to come to the UK and to Europe as both the ECB and the BOE try to figure out what their next moves are.